So in episode 3 of The Outsider, Jessa gives Ralph a very interesting message. We meet a new character by the name of Holly, and Detective Jack isn't looking so great. We're going to talk about that and much more. Episode 3 of The Outsider is titled Dark Uncle. Despite being on mandatory leave, Ralph continues to scrutinize the circumstances surrounding the night of the murder. Jack has a hair-raising experience at a remote barn where key evidence and a mysterious substance has been found. What's going on, everybody? Elliot back again with my weekly recap, breakdown, review of the latest episode of HBO's The Outsider, episode 3. Very excited to break down this episode for you all in this spoiler-filled discussion. Before we dive into it, for those that are new to this channel, what are we all about at Movie Files? Well, we review the latest movies, TV shows, we react to the latest trailers, we do unboxings for new Blu-rays, and we also do giveaways and so much more. So if you haven't already, definitely subscribe. And if and when you've seen this episode of Outsider, I gotta know what you thought of the episode. Let me know your thoughts in the comments, your theories, all the stuff you like and didn't like about this episode. Let's have some fun discussions down there. I reviewed the first 2 episodes last week, and I can't thank you all enough for the awesome comments, and I'm very excited to jump into this review. Again, this is a spoiler discussion, so if you haven't seen this latest episode of The Outsider, go check it out, come back, and let's break it down. So, what an interesting episode. We meet this character. A lot of you all, like I said, left a lot of great comments. Mentioned, wait till you meet Holly. Wait till you meet Holly. And we meet her in this episode, played by Cynthia Erivo, who just blew up on the scene last year with Bad Times at the El Royale and just so many different performances, Widows, and she's in Harriet of last year. So she's been blowing up on the scene, so I was very excited to see her appear on the show, and we get her in this episode. So let's just kind of break it down briefly. So the episode immediately picks up after episode 2, where we go to the barn, and we see that they're the GPI, I believe is their police force. They find the clothes that Terry was wearing the night that he went to the strip club. And in finding those clothes, you know, we see the belt buckle. We also get this really, like I read in the synopsis, this really interesting substance on one of Terry's socks, or Terry, as we used to say, this doppelganger, as we'll talk a little bit about later, or dark uncle. We see this substance that kind of breaks off, and I'm thinking, okay, it looks like old skin. Again, we're going to dive into all the theories in a bit there. So we start off there, and then again, it looks like a dry substance. So, you know, what's the deal with Jack, right? So we meet Jack's character, I believe in episode 2, if I'm not mistaken, and we see, I know a lot of you have mentioned that he seems to be a little bit off, you know, he seems to be on edge. We know that his hunting trip was kind of cut short after this, you know, murder case and everything involved there, but he's going to the strip club, we see him there. He seems to want to pick fights. But the biggest thing that we learned with Jack in this episode is as he goes to the barn, and this is where the kind of the creepy, supernatural kind of horror elements of the show kind of peep up in the show here. So we see he goes to the barn, and he's flashing his little light, and he sees a figure in the background. And obviously kind of startled by that, he picks up his gun, and by the time he puts his light back in the area that he saw the figure, they're missing. But then, I don't know if it was on my TV or if it was your TV, but kind of in the background, you see this kind of dark figure walking up to him, and it seems as we see later in the episode, he's scratched by this figure, and he's talking to the figure, and like, hey, I'm a police officer. And again, we don't see anyone on screen at this point, but again, on my screen, it looks like there was someone behind him talking to him, and we get more of those scenes later in the episode. But very interesting thing there. So again, we can kind of talk about it in the comments now, but as I mentioned in my first 2 reviews of this show, for those that have read the book, that is so awesome. I know you guys are probably like, oh, I can't wait for them to find this and the other, but definitely don't spoil anything in the comments. But as far as theories right now, I assume this is what this figure does. He approaches these people. I don't know how he picks 6 victims, as we'll probably learn later in the season, but he picks Ralph, or picks Jack, scratches him, and then again, I don't know if this is alluding to the process, the transformation of whatever this thing is doing and taking up the form of the people that he attacks. So very interesting there. He's in pain, and again, I don't know if this is part of the process, but we'll talk about Jack a little bit later, because again, this reminds me of the episode that we got last, with Jessa telling Ralph about the scratch that Terry got. And again, I don't know if this is connecting how this figure is getting these victims, how he's transforming into them. I don't know. Let me know in the comments. Again, book readers, no spoilers. So from there, you know, we find out that the prince that they found on the crime scene, and at the crime scene, but at the barn, seems to match Terry's prints, but it seems to be prints of an 80 or 90 year old person, which is very interesting there. And again, more of this mysterious substance. So, you know, we go back to, Gloria, and we find out the kids are no longer able to go to school because a lot of the children at their school feel on edge because of the whole murder and everything, and thinking that their dad did it. So that was, you know, kind of a moment there. But really the biggest thing that I gathered from this episode, outside of Jess's message to Ralph, which we'll talk about here, but we meet Holly. You know, again, Cynthia Erivo, I think, is a great actress, and she has a really bright future, but we meet her. And again, she seems to be one of these kind of unique characters that Stephen King brings in his books, and definitely unique is the word that they continue to call her. She seems to have an incredible memory. She seems to know everything about everything, from sports, events, and time. She's a car expert. I mean, she knows everything. So very unique character, and very particular about certain things. When we saw her at the bar, she was like, hey, you can stay there, but you're in my seat. You need to move. So very particular type of person. And we get a little bit about a little bit inside of her backstory, that her parents tried to get her studied and see what's going on with her. And again, I don't know, again, Stephen King connective tissues to other books and other people in his kind of Stephen King universe, but her abilities or her uniqueness kind of reminded me of Jack Torrance in The Shining. I don't know if she's shining at all or she has some type of shining ability, but I thought that she was a very unique character, and very excited to see her interact more with Ralph and learn more about this case and interact with other people, because she seems to be very unique, and I'm wondering how other people are going to react to her, because she's a very, again, unique character, and I'm very excited to see more of Cynthia Erivo in this role. But, you know, with her character, you know, she, when she meets Ralph for the first time, she says, you know, she believes in myths, and she brought up the word doppelganger. She brought up the title of this episode, you know, Dark Uncle, and her, you know, idea of the, you know, that there's a person maybe that's not a twin, but is someone that mirrors, you know, your identity. So very interesting theories there. I think I might have mentioned, you know, some doppelganger situation going on in the first two episodes that might be going on, you know, reminding me a little bit of Jordan Peele's Us. So very interesting things that we get there. We see Holly goes to the Matlin's hotel room that they stayed in March, and she seemed to have some type of flashback. Again, I don't know if she's shining or if it's just her unique sensibilities and her skills per se, but, you know, we see that moment there, and some supernatural vibes for her seeing that. But she also tries to visit Terry's dad, but they want to let her to go up because they're saying that she's, you know, she might be a reporter, or she might, you know, the detectives interviewed his dad. And I'm like, interviewed him? Because obviously at that point in time, when the secretary said that, you know, this was weeks ago, well, Terry just died. So what's really going on? And then when we see Holly kind of investigating this, you know, what happened with the dad and why were people interviewing him? Well, we find out that there was a murder in this area, and that there was two missing girls that ended up murdered. And the murderer happened to be a hospital worker, which starts to maybe put the pieces together. Was he a hospital worker at the same hospital that Terry's dad was at? And again, Terry went to go visit his dad. He got a cut. What happened there? We'll talk about that scene at the jail scene, but I think there's some connective tissues going on there with that hospital worker maybe knowing Terry's dad, maybe Terry's dad having something to do with it. Again, they said there was the fingerprints on that belt buckle was from an 80 or 90-year-old gentleman, but it's Terry's DNA. I don't know. Let me know your thoughts in the comments there. But very interesting stuff that we find out with Holly's character and tying everything together. And it's coming together pretty well. So, you know, we get Ralph and a little bit of him on his therapy session. And see him at his worst when he, you know, when his son Derek died. We get that moment there. But we also get more of Jessa, which is Terry's daughter, little daughter, and she has more dreams or nightmares, or as the parents are kind of alluding to. And we also see a scene where there's a dark figure that covers up her face pretty quickly. We didn't really, you know, dive into that, but I assume that's the, you know, the mysterious figure. But the big thing that we get from Jessa's character this episode is, you know, she wakes up her, or stands in front of her mom's bed very creepily, as a little girl shouldn't be doing. So she goes to her mom's bed and has her phone and says, you need to call Detective Ralph. So they do so. Ralph tries to get some information out of her because she has a message for him, but the mom isn't really liking Ralph's approach. So she lets Jeannie, Ralph's wife, interview or kind of question Jessa about her dream. And she tells Jeannie that, yeah, I've seen this figure four times now. First time being, you know, he looked like my dad, but he was very mean and tried to make me cry. Second time he came to visit me, he was kind of different looking, a little messy looking, and his face looked blurry. I don't know if that's connecting back to Jack and maybe another transformation, or maybe that hospital worker, maybe he was transforming into him, or all that would make sense. Well, I don't know, timeline wise, because I don't know. Let me know what you guys are thinking there. But, you know, she says his face was blurry. And then the third time, he was stronger and looked different. So, again, is this Jack stronger, different, or another victim that might have killed girls? I don't know. Very interesting conversation there. But the biggest thing that Jessa said was, hey, Ralph, you need to stop what you're doing, and you should be scared. So very interesting message there for Jessa. And apparently the guy is not going to visit her anymore. But we'll see, because it doesn't look like Ralph's going to be taking that advice that Jessa gave him. So very interesting scene there. So as we wrap up the episode, we get these cut scenes throughout the episode of this a black guy and a white guy in a jail cell. And we see that they're both kind of preparing to take each other out. As the episode kind of progresses, we eventually find out that the black guy is the guy that was arrested for the murder of those two girls. And, you know, he goes in this, you know, this seems like the cops let the white guy into his jail cell to kill him. But the black guy says to the white guy, you know, you're not supposed to be the one who does this, and I'm not gonna let you do this. He said, well, it doesn't matter, and he's gonna kill him. But then the guy slits his own throat. So that leads into the very last scene in the episode, where we see Jack on the edge of his bed, I assume, saying that I'll do whatever you need me to do. I'll do whatever you need me to do. He says it several times. So very interesting transformation there. It looks like Jack is going to be doing whatever Terry did, maybe, and whatever this mysterious figure is. When he takes his victims, he gets in their heads. He makes them feel pain and feel horrible. So it looks like Jack might be the next person to murder some kids. Again, no spoilers for the book readers, but some questions I had is, what's the deal with this mysterious figure and killing kids? And not just killing them, but brutally murdering kids. And how does he go about choosing these kids? How does he go about choosing his victims to do this evil deeds? A lot of good stuff in this episode for me personally. We learn a little bit about Ralph's background, again, about his drinking habits when Derek died. It looks like him and Jeannie had a bit of a rough patch there. Again, we find out more about Jessa and her dreams and her message to Ralph. And then again, the biggest thing is, I think Jack might be the next one that's going to be maybe killing the next kid. So we'll see what's going to happen there. I'm so on board with the show, three episodes in. Again, it reminds me of a great Stephen King novel. It reminds me of this True Detective on HBO, and just all the great things that we've getting in this supernatural type of genre that we get in shows and movies. So I'm very on board. I really enjoyed this episode. It answers some questions from last week. Again, doppelganger, dark horse, or dark uncle. These messages, you know, what's Cynthia Erivo's character Holly going to do to get this information from the, you know, the security guard? So I'm on board. Let me know what you all thought of episode 3 of The Outsider Dark Horse. Let me know your pros, your cons, your theories. Again, no spoilers for the book readers. Let's all have a fun time enjoying and unwrapping this mystery. As you all can see, there's a little bit of a different setup here for me. I just recently moved over the weekend. Very fun times, because we all know moving's fun, right? But I will be kind of getting this situated here in the next coming weeks as far as making this background a little bit more appealing than my past setup. So there you have it, guys. That's my thought on this recent episode. I really enjoyed it. I'm on board. I can't wait to find out more about this mystery and this mysterious figure and the substance and all that stuff that's going on there. Give this video a like and a thumbs up. Really helps out the channel. Again, comment below, subscribe to my channel, hit that bell so you can stay up to date with all my content, my movie reviews, TV reviews, and all the fun things we do on this very show. Follow me on all my social media accounts, as well as keep an eye out for some more content coming pretty soon. Thank you all for watching this review, and we'll see you on the next video.